disclosure. There we go. Access to this webinar is for educational and informational purposes only. Consult a licensed broker, registered investment advisor before placing any trades. All securities in order to discuss and track and monitor in virtual trading accounts, virtual account prices and returns may differ from actual trading results. Commission costs are excluded. Neither BillStockWorld.com, BSW, nor its affiliates, nor any of their respective officers, personnel, representatives, agents, or independent contractors in such capacities, licensed financial advisors, registered investment advisors, or registered broker dealers, nothing in the webinar website or commercial material constitutes promotion, recommendation, or solicitation, or offer of any particular investment, security, or transaction. Trading options involve risk. Visit the OTC website, www.optionsclearing.com, to read characteristics of standardized options. PSW provides education and training for services. For the to teach you the risks and potential rewards of trading options, and we are not the service that tells you what to trade. We are not implying guaranteeing any profit. As always, do not trade with money you cannot afford to lose. Past performance does not equal future results, and results of this webinar are not typical and are only valid on that specific identified date. Your results may vary. By accessing this webinar, you agree to hold yourself harmless from any losses you may incur as a result of the information discussed in the media identified above. By accessing this webinar, you agree to be placed on our mailing list and receive our newsletter. Rest assured, we take your privacy very seriously, and we will not distribute or sell your information to anyone. Fantastic. All right, what's going on in the markets? That's what the big question for the day. Wrong thinkorswim, bad thinkorswim. 64-bit thinkorswim is our friend. All right, we are up and up and up today. Oh, we missed 2060 to short. Oh, that pisses me off. Okay, I wanted to short when we got there. Here's the dollar. The dollar's coming back a little bit. Another good reason to start shorting. How is our friend Mr. Oil? Mr. Oil is over 49. Mr. Gasoline is not really exciting. Mr. Gasoline is down at 152. So there's no particular reason to go long gasoline right this second, but conceptually, I still like gas long into the weekend, looking for 155 at least. You know, into Friday's close, or before Friday's close, 155. Get there, I'm going to be very happy, and we're at 152 right now. Where's the bottom here? 1515 has been the bottom. So I guess we can play gasoline long here as well. Not if the dollar's rising though. The dollar's coming back. That's the problem. Let's let the dollar come back first and see how it goes. All right, and he's at 205.4. I really did want to short that. Let's see, ES and TF near that, Mr. Russell. And the Russell also coming back down from 1125. So both would have been good shorting spots a few minutes ago at 1230. But no real enthusiasm doing it. So let's just leave it alone and read the news and see what happens. Overall, blah, 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 blah. We got, where's Nikkei? Here's Nikkei. Nikkei's drifting 1115750. And again, with the rising dollar, you can't short the Nikkei. So, you know, if you got a couple of lines here, you got 120, you got 435, let's say 55 over here, 17550 again was another better shorter line. And look, see, it's that nice red line here. You love shorting these red lines. Here's a red line, here's a red line. It's hard for the market to get over that red line, especially when we already think it's going to be only making a bounce off the old levels. That second red line is what they call resistance two. The support, you know, there's support one and support two, and resistance one and resistance two. That's what these lines are on the pivot points. And when you get up to resistance two, that's pretty much with this, what they call a standard deviation. That's about as much range as you're going to usually get for the day. So when you see your indexes all hitting those lines and getting rejected at those lines, you don't need me to tell you it's time to go short. All right, hang on one second, check over here for something. And put the charts up over there. Right. All right. Anywho, so now's a good time to check in on our portfolios just to see how we're doing, but let's see if anyone has a question first. How about a recap of the last 4 days and how the chaos created a flexible world? I just did that for CNBC, so you have to read the article. Somebody interviewed me this morning from CNBC. And he was really asking me about what the second half of the year will be. But look, what happened? Nobody was paying attention to the Brexit. We were. We thought the market would go down. It did. But it went down, I don't know. It's like, you know what it's like? It's like when you have kids and you watch them walking by the oven and you tell them not to touch the oven to the top. And you know that they like to touch things. And you know the oven is hot. And you know they're going to get burned. It's a fact. And you warn them they're going to get burned. And then they do it anyway. And they get burned. And it's hard to have pity on them because they get burned. But now they react like it's a complete surprise. They touch the oven, it's hot. I mean the outside, not obviously sticking their head in it. But they touch the oven, it's hot, they hurt their hand, and they start crying, and they go, oh, it's so unfair, oh my God, I can't believe it. And you're like, I told you 10 times it was going to be hot, and you were going to burn yourself. But they act like it's a complete surprise, and you're like, well, they're young, they'll learn. And yet, no. Okay, here we have millions and millions of investors who can't see something incredibly obvious until it happens. Doesn't matter how many times you tell them, it doesn't matter how often they're warned, they just don't believe it until it stings them. And they act like it's a total shock. That's my summer. Like freaking children. I mean, I don't know what else to say. I mean, it's just unbelievable that something as obvious as that would cause such turmoil when it was such a, when there was no question of what was going to happen. And not only that, though, but even to the point where I was saying, and after it happens, it's not going to be a big deal because it's 2 years to unwind this thing. Nothing happened. All they did was voted to fill out a form, the 50 form, whatever it's called. They voted to fill out a form to begin the process, the 2-year process of getting out. And Cameron resigned, and that means it's another 3 months before they have a new prime minister when they can actually fill out the form. So because of that, the price of gasoline went down? That's insane. And it's just as insane because that the stock prices went down. But the stock prices were too high anyway, and they needed to correct themselves. And that's why I don't think we're coming back. All we're doing now is recognizing one of the many risks that are still in the market. That was risk number one that we had for the summer. Risk number two is our earnings. Okay, so right after July 4th, we get into earnings season. July 11th is October, so officially kicks off July 11th. So there's several things that happen now. First of all, we have this thing. That's over. Brexit's over. It's done. The next big thing that happens is earnings on the 11th. Also around the same time, though, here's another weird thing. At the same time, America turns its attention to another thing that nobody's ever heard of before, and that's Brazil. Brazil is a government that has no leader, whose president is being impeached, whose government is in disarray, which has scandals, bribery, so on and so forth. The economy is in complete shambles, and there's a huge outbreak of a horrible, horrible virus that causes women to give birth to deformed children. Okay? That's next on the list. After that, not after that, actually, at any time at all, China, with their massive debt, slowing economy, and by the way, China completely fell apart last August, right? So now it's coming into August, so let's call August China time. And there's certain reasons China falls apart in August, including the fact that August is the 8th month of the year, and Chinese people freak out about the number 8. There's August coming up. And China has massive corporate debt, another round in the second quarter. You're going to hear all kinds of corporate defaults again on bonds and so on and so forth. You've got the second half of the year, the governments who are on fiscal year have to admit that they have no money and their budgets are blown. Then you've got the indebtedness of the people and so on and so forth. So bad, bad China could blow up at any time, probably in August. Then you've got Japan. 250% of their GDP as debt. So that would be like us having $50 trillion in debt. Okay? And every time rates, and if rates go up 1%, we would have to come up with $500 billion in additional interest payments just to keep ourselves from going further into debt. No, I'm sorry, not to keep, I mean, not really to go stop, because we're still, and they're running a 10% deficit at the same time. So we would have a $50 trillion deficit and be adding $2 trillion a year to the deficit at that pace, and then we'd need another $500 billion if interest rates went from 0% to 1%. That's where Japan is right now. So, and as I'm saying, that's proportional to the U.S. It's easy to talk about U.S. numbers, it's less abstract. There's that, and then there's Venezuela, a complete catastrophe to the point where the lights are barely staying on in the country, where people are digging garbages for food and so on and so forth. And at any moment, that entire country can completely break down and have a revolution. And it's right near Venezuela, so I mean, right near Brazil. So other than that, everything's great. So you go, go ahead and buy stocks at the top, but I think not. So I'm not rushing back in. Okay, as tempting as it may look, I'm not rushing back into the market. As tempting as the squiggly lines on a chart look, anyway, because I don't think the global macro is not tempting. It's not. Cash is very tempting. Gold is very tempting. Not running into stocks and paying 20 times their earnings. Oh, and they're fake propped up earnings, because you're paying 20 times the earnings of a stock that's bought back all its shares so that its earnings per share look better. There's that too. One day that'll hit the fan also, all these buybacks that they wasted their money on. So BP sends it for, okay. I'd like to read more about that, because that's interesting to me. I really didn't know that would make a difference, but maybe these special LNG ships are on. We shall see. That's going to be, I guess, good. I don't know if it's good or bad for natural gas, so if they start shipping through the canal. It depends where it's coming from. All these lines, someone on your team adjusting daily? What? No, we don't do anything. These lines are what they call on... Damn it! it says not my other computer doesn't do that. That's why. The lines are a study. So when you're in Thinkorswim, you find pattern analysis tools, they're called. And you, nope, that's wrong, sorry. There it is. Okay, so under the beaker, which means analysis tool, and you go to study and you say add a study. If you don't have it on your chart, you go to add a study, you go to trend study, you go to P, and it says pivot point. And that's it. That's all this is. It's a pivot point study. It's the only study I use. I just find it nice because it sort of quick draws ranges that TA people like to look at. And that's all I care about. And because if you're going to turn, again, I only care about TA because probably 80% of the people trading, 85%, 90% of the people trading trade based on TA, don't trade based on fundamentals. So TA becomes a fundamental I have to care about, right? If, look, if everybody, when the sun hit the top, when the sun was at the zenith at noon, everybody dropped to the floor and started praying to the east, for some wacky reason, right? If everybody did that, then I would probably start betting that every day when the sun gets to noon, I'll bet all those people drop to the floor and start praying to the east. And you'd be like, well, that makes no sense. And I'd be like, well, I bet they're going to do it. And I would make a lot of money making those bets. Okay? So fundamentally, I know a bunch of people are going to drop to the floor and start praying to the east at noon just because they do. But they'll believe that they're doing it because of God and whatever they have to, and they're this, whatever, blah, blah, blah. Meanwhile, I'm just saying, I don't care why they're doing it. They just do it, okay? That's what TEA is for, fundamentalist, okay? I don't care why people are doing these trades. This is what they do, and it's really easy to observe because they're a bunch of sheep. They all do the same goddamn thing. They all follow these stupid squiggly lines. They think it matters, and because they think it matters, it starts to matter. If enough people think it matters, then it's going to matter. So that's what TA is. That's why I like these lines, because these lines are really easy to watch, very easy to follow, and this is what the TA people like to do. So these I will watch. And of course our 5% lines, which are a different thing, but that supersedes these. But when they line up, when the 5% line agrees with these guys, that's when it's a very powerful tool. All right. Lost screens, blue screen, can't get a blue screen, so out. This always happens, fixed. This always happens, I'm out. Okay, I'm back, it's fixed. Okay, I don't know. Usually, when you guys use it, you guys have to reboot. That's, you know, unless everybody's out, it's just a shared thing. I don't see how it goes. You may be a sheep and you picked an awesome shepherd. Yeah, I don't want to be a shepherd. That's the thing. I want to teach you to be the wolf. That's my goal, okay? I don't want you to be, I don't want shepherds, I don't want sheep, I want people to be wolves, okay? There's plenty of sheep. We can eat all day long, anytime we want, because there's so many freaking sheep out there. And that's what I want to get across to everybody, is that you can see this stuff. It's easy picking. You just got to learn to read the signs, that's all. All right, and unfortunately, you know, look, unfortunately, you have to learn to be a skeptic. It's not, it's you know, a lot of people say, you know, you join PSW, it's like taking the red pill in the Matrix or whichever pill it is. So, you know, you wake up and you realize the entire world isn't what you thought it was. Unfortunately, that's kind of true in the markets, because you do. You kind of, you know, in the Matrix, you give the guy the pill and he comes out of that horrible little capsule he's in, and he sees that the whole world is fake and he's just in this little capsule. But once you get out and once you realize that, you don't want to go back in the capsule. You can see the world for what it is. And that's what you have to learn to do. You have to learn to see stuff for what it is. You have to learn that these people on TV are just manipulating you. The people who are in the paper are just manipulating you. The guy who owns the paper is manipulating you. Everybody is trying to manipulate you. Because you're just a bundle of money to them. That's all you are. You are a consumer. And all they want to do is get your money. You've got money, they want money. That's, you know, I mean, that pretty much sums up almost all the interactions you have during the day, right? You've got money, people want your money. It's sad and it makes you cynical and it takes a lot of the fun out of life, but once you understand that, you start understanding the motives for all these people and what they're doing. So, so you have to be a bit cynical about looking at things, but then once you understand the motivation and what's going on and why does George Soros say this? George Soros, by the way, got killed on the frickin' Brexit because he bet the wrong way. After all that bullshitting about what he was talking about, he bet it wouldn't happen. He made those statements to scare people so that they would bet the other way, and he was wrong. He was right about it being a catastrophe, but he was wrong because he bet it wouldn't be a catastrophe. But he only said it to manipulate the market. He said it to push the vote one way or another. He was counting on all the English people who hate George Soros, who crashed the British pound like 30 years ago, or 20-something years ago. Yeah, 25 years ago. So 25 years ago, George Soros broke the Bank of England by manipulating the currency. It wasn't illegal. He just did it because he could. So he got, you know, people hate him, but they fear him, and they respect his word. He uses all that psychology to try to get his way. But as I said, because I am a cynical bastard, I said, look, even the betting, all these people telling you that the Brexit vote. The stupidest thing was the odds, because people are like, oh, the odds of the Brexit vote are 3-1 that they're going to stay. There's no way that the brokers can be that wrong. And that's because people don't understand what odds are. When the odds are 3-1, you know, look, okay, like a horse, right? When you're at the track, a horse isn't a favorite because people think it's going to win. It's not a favorite because the people at the track who are taking the bets, they don't think it's going to win. They don't give a crap. And a horse isn't a long shot because people at the track think it's not going to win. That's got nothing to do with it. The horse is, they have an odds maker who sets the early odds. But once that happens, then something called parimutuel betting takes effect. And that means that if you put a lot, if more money, that's the key that makes everyone confused. If more money is put on the number one horse, the number one horse becomes a favorite and the odds go down. If less money, the least amount of money, is put on the number 10 horse, the number 10 horse becomes the long shot and the odds go up. Why? The odds are manipulating you. The odds are just a way of attracting money. They want your money too. The number one horse doesn't want your money, so it gives you bad odds because they've already got a lot of money on the number one horse. The number 10 horse doesn't have a lot of money, so it gives you higher and higher odds because there's not much money bet on it. So they're like, we don't give a crap because what the track has already calculated, like the lottery system, they take like 50% of the money off the top of the skin, and they only pay back half the money anyway. So of the half the money, there's then a pool of odds. Same thing goes for the British odds makers, okay? They take a skim off the top of everything's bet, and of the rest is bet, they just try to make the odds to attract money to both sides. In this case, a tremendous amount of money was being bet on Remain, amount of money, and a much lesser amount of money was being bet on Lee, so they kept pumping so the odds for Remaining got lower and lower payoffs, and the odds for Leaving got higher and higher payoffs and became 3-1 against Leaving. But the number, here's the key, the number of bets, and here's where understanding that thing made the whole difference. I'm not changing the screen anyway, so it doesn't matter. I don't understand why it works and doesn't work, though. It's a weird thing. It could be a Java issue on your side, maybe. I don't know. Anyway. So the key for us, that we realized that the Brexit was likely to happen, is it was the number, the actual number count of bets was much higher for Leaving than Remaining. They were just lower dollar value bets. And that's the problem. And then you start thinking about the psychology. You say, well, what's going on here? And it's because the rich people who don't know anything except for they like things the way they are, they said, these people, these sheep, are never going to leave. They'll never vote to leave because we've done a good job scaring them and telling them how horrible it will be for them to leave. So they're scared, and we're going to stay. So I'm going to put my $1,000 bet on Remain. And rich people do live in a bubble. And all you people who are watching this on a computer live in a bubble. You've got an internet connection. You've got computers. You've got money to invest. You're in a freaking bubble. Okay, you're not in the same world that the guy who washes your who wipes your windows at the car washes it. You do not understand that world. Even if you used to be in that world. Okay, I say I did enough crappy jobs in my lifetime. I was a bus boy. I was I packed things in warehouses. I sat out of stupid lines like all day long for a month straight, just putting things in boxes. So I've done my share of crappy work, but you still, you can't go back. You just don't, you forget so easily what it is to have those kind of problems. You forget what it's like to have to get up at 8 o'clock in the morning and have to be at the job and have to do this mindless work all day long, come home exhausted, but you still got to do everything because you can't afford to have people do anything for you. Your life is just consumed with work and then housework and chores and so on and so forth, and your mind is just different. You don't sleep the same. You don't think the same. You know, it's a different world for the people who work for a living, the bottom 80% of the people who live day to day with no extra money, no savings, no insurance, no nothing. Anything goes wrong, they're screwed. It's a different life for these people. And the people who have money, which is us, do not understand what they're thinking as much as you like to think you do. So it's those people who are taking their $5 bets and placing millions and millions of $5 bets on Leaving because that's what they were going to vote. And they said, we are seeing people leaving. Everyone, they say those people, the vast majority, were saying, hey, everyone I talked to says we're leaving. And they knew that. And if it wasn't for Scotland, by the way, because Scotland wanted to stay, if it wasn't for Scotland, which overwhelmingly voted to stay, so they had a different mindset about everything than the rest of the UK, there it literally would have been like 75% going the other way to leave the EU. But when the news people go, everybody got it wrong. They're in the bubble too. Okay? They don't know. I mean, yeah, you do talk to these people. You talk to working people. I got guys, in fact, right outside my window right now, there's like five guys building stairs for my neighbor. And they're probably the kind of guys Trump would send home. But you know, I don't like them. They're hardworking guys. I've sat down with them. I've brought them some drinks a couple of times. But you know, for me to sit there and tell these guys I know what their life is like, it's ridiculous. You know, they don't have the same life as me. They're busting their ass hauling stone all day long for the last 3 days. They go home to a completely different life than I have. Right, I always wonder that. It's always tough. I mean, because they're working on these really expensive houses and doing all this work. You know, it's not the same life, and you can't think that you understand what's going on. And as we have more and more of this inequality and wealth gap, there's less and less understanding. And this is a great example. This is the thing about now. This is my main point about this, though. It's not just this one thing. And it's much worse than it seems because, again, if you look at the vote, well, let's see. I can probably show you. Brexit vote map. Da-da-da-da-da. Result. Here you go. Good old BBC. What is that? That's a terrible map. All right, well, here. See up in Scotland? See these light colors? I don't know how well you can see it. But 0%, you know, 0 to 30% down here. All around Scotland, 0 to 30%. The rest of England, 70%, 60%, 50%. Okay, much, much higher concentrations in the UK, or in the England, Scotland, and Wales? Is that it? In England and Wales, this is Wales around here. My grandfather was Welsh, actually. I don't know anything about it, but I know somewhere around here. So you've got really different areas of the country, but the big thing here is without these votes, it wouldn't have been close. Without these guys being like 70-something percent in favor of staying, and over here too. Okay, so it's very, very different, especially in the working man poor part of England out here. So, you know, people get things very, very, very wrong. Leave top five there in Boston. I didn't really have a Boston. The Remain share vote mapped. Oh, here you go. Okay, you can see here too. Okay, so here's the Remains in an opposite map, and you can see here. Look at that. It's barely colored. It's way over here in this range, and then you get to the yellow, which is way out there. All right, so the key takeaway from this whole thing is that we do not understand what's going on anymore because we've gotten so far removed from the peasants, essentially, that we're not even speaking the same language, that the people in the press are not those people. Once you have a job in the media, once you're getting paid $50,000 a year and you're on TV, you immediately do not understand. You no longer understand. And everybody can say, oh, I came from this or I came from that, but you don't understand. Okay? Actors are a great example of that. My cousin's a screenwriter. So I meet a lot of actors out in LA. And they all love to tell you how poor they used to be. But they're not poor anymore, and it's amazing how fast they forget. You know, I especially one of my big things is restaurants too, because I'm a good tipper because I worked in restaurants most of my life. When I was young, I worked in restaurants. I realized that was like the best job, so I stuck with it for a long time because we got all the tips. So I've always been a good tipper. I always give back. I mean, if I really don't like somebody, I give them 15%, and I give a lot more if somebody's a good waiter. So what people who don't tip drive me nuts. So. And it's so funny though when I'm out in LA and I'm going out with people and I see them leave like a crappy tip if I'm not paying, and I'm like, what are you doing? And they're like, he wasn't that good. He's like, I used to be a waiter. I know he wasn't that good. It's like, well, if he used to be a waiter, you should realize it's like it's a whole, you know, sometimes you have a bad day. It's not really your fault. And it's funny though. I mean, how could you have been a waiter? And that's what they say. I was a waiter 5 years ago. I was a waiter. I'm like, 5 years ago you're a waiter and already you're acting like this. But that's what happens. Okay, people have jobs. They have security. Their life changes quickly. And they start deluding themselves, and it's all because of their hard work, and it wasn't because they happened to be lucky and got a part. Or, you know, you get lucky, you get a raise, whatever. And this is how you lose sight of things. And this is very important for us, and the reason I'm spending time on this, it's important for us because you have to try to remember where you came from. You have to try to remember what life is like at that level because you're investing with real people. You're investing in companies that service real people. And on the other hand, though, when you invest in a company like Tesla, or the other one was a good example is GoPro, because I said GoPro was way overpriced. But it turns out that the perfect IPO in this kind of market is any kind of company where rich people like the stock, and there's not that much stock. So a company like GoPro is a fairly small company, and there's enough people who like GoPro, or Tesla is the same thing, where they'll buy the car, and they'll buy some stock, and they don't care what it costs, because they have no concept. They just go, oh, it's a good company. I like Tesla, because I drive a Tesla. So they'll buy an $80,000 car, and they'll buy $5,000, $10,000 worth of stock. Well, you know, if you think about it, if you sell 20,000 cars and 20,000 people buy $10,000 worth of stock, that's $200 million worth of stock. All of a sudden it's getting bought and put away. And obviously some of those people are going to be rich and they're going to spend a lot more than 20, and they'll spend a lot more than their share on the stock. Not everyone buys the stock, you know what I mean. I mean, some one guy buys $1 million worth of stock, throws the whole curve off. Nobody's buying negative $1 million, so the curve only goes higher than what you think, basically. So all these companies get overexcited because rich people like it, but liking something doesn't mean it's a good company. You know, where McDonald's is a classic example. I hate McDonald's. I can't stand the place. I think they make a bad version of almost everything they do. But love the stock because people like it. And so you have to divorce yourself from like what you like and what's real and what makes money. And to do that, though, you have to be able to look very objectively at what all people across all walks of life like, and then focus on what the people who are customers of the companies that you're doing business with that you want to invest in have. You know, when you invest in healthcare, your customer is mostly the insurance companies and the government. I mean, obviously, you have to do the numbers, how many people are sick, but then how many of those sick people have insurance, how many of those people who are sick have insurance that will approve this method of treatment, so on and so forth. That's what matters in healthcare. Not whether it helps anyone or not, who the hell cares? Does it get approved? Can it be put on a schedule that somebody can follow? Will doctors recommend it? And will healthcare coverage pay for it? That's what matters. Not whether or not it actually cures anything. That's a complete side coincidence if that happens. That's why people get very confused with biotech investing. Okay, it's not enough to just have a cure. It's not enough to just make progress in something. You've got to beat your competition. You've got to replace it in doctor recommendations. It's got to be approved by insurance, so your pricing has to be right. You know, that sleazy guy who wrote, you know, rose the prices of the drug, they squashed him like a bug, because if everyone started doing that, the insurance companies would go broke. So they destroyed him and his company. And then Vertex followed. Well, not Vertex, Alien, sorry. I was confused. VR. But and then all biotech started getting a problem. It's all backlash from this one instance. Oh, by the way, that's a very important point, so we'll get to that later, but my My stock for the second half of the year is going to be LABU, because I really like biotech for a comeback in the second half of the year. All right, next question. Boy, see you started there? Who did that? I think it was Latch. With his long question. Where was that? There he was. Nope, that was not the question. All right, I don't care. There it was, recap. BP sent the LNG cargo, okay. Okay. Lost screens again. Hope that came back. So we are arguing over strong bounces back from disaster. Should NKD continue to? Yes, but you got to watch the dollar with the Nikkei. So, if the dollar is going up, that's good for the Nikkei. So if we want to see the Nikkei catching up, the Nikkei is at 750 now. If we can get the dollar back over 96, which is having a lot of trouble here, let's see if we can zoom in a little bit. See, rejected. And by the way, if you're going to be using the support resistance lines, if you reject it at support, that's weak, right? You shouldn't be rejected at support. You should be rejected at resistance, not support. So if you fail the support line, come back to the support line and get rejected at the support line, that's not a sign of strength. Don't think it is, okay? When you're rejected at resistance, that's not a sign of weakness. Everybody here is still strong because all they did is get stopped and they're kind of consolidating at their resistance lines. But these guys all look like they can leg up tomorrow. And they just might because, frankly, I mean, it's a window dressing days anyway. So in a normal market, they would be going up. And I just told those CNBC guys that copper would probably catch up if things go well, and it is. So the dollar is still weak. So fact number one, dollar is still weak, which is not good for Nikkei betting. It is good for everybody else, weaker dollar, instead of for the indexes. Now, we don't like that the dollar is still down a half a point for the day, so you subtract a half a point from these guys. And then you got to look at where the dollar's been for the last couple of days, but the dollar's up pretty significantly. How far back does this go? Okay, so the dollar was 93, now it's 96. So the dollar's up 3%, and we have like a 5% bounce, right? So if the dollar's up 3% and the market's up 5%, you got to subtract the 3% from the dollar from the bounce, and that means that really the bounce is only about 2%. And 2% is a weak bounce. So what we have is a weak bounce that's been aided by the dollar. And you always have to factor that in. Why is that? Because the dollar tends to come back to where it belongs. Oh, wait, I'm sorry, I said that backwards. Stop myself. The dollar is up 3%, I'm sorry. The dollar is up 3%, that handicaps the move, I'm sorry. So this is actually a stronger move than it looks like. I apologize, I got that totally backwards, stupid. The dollar is up 3%. That handicaps everything 3%, which means that this is actually a really strong recovery because it did it despite the dollar gaining 3%. Okay? So we had a, I don't know, what was yesterday? Yesterday was like I think we had almost a 5% recovery plus the dollar 3%. So now what we're saying is we're almost back to where we were. Very close. So sorry I started that off wrong because I'm just getting backwards. But because the dollar is strong, okay, then anything that's priced in dollars should be lower, right? If the dollar is stronger, then something that's priced in dollars, like our stocks, would be lower. So the strong dollar handicaps the market move. And oil and gasoline and everything else. So I still like gasoline long, I still like oil long, although oil's getting to 50, so not as good. But gasoline here, which just crossed 15250, I do like, and I like it to the 155 line. I wasn't paying attention, we should have made that bet. So as soon as the dollar starts going down again, then Nikkei should start doing well. And also, though, we're still expecting the Bank of Japan to do something. They keep talking about it, but that's That's usually their MO. They talk and talk and talk, and then finally they have to do something. You're talking like Nigel Farage is the EU Parliament yesterday. He killed him. Yeah, he is. He's cool. And you know what's funny, though? He's, you know, when you peel back the onion on that guy, though, he is basically, he's a kind of racist guy, very much like Trump, but smarter. I mean, that's what he is. I said yesterday, if Trump were well-spoken, I'd probably like him a lot better, because that guy is, he's smart, he's quick, he's funny, and he's a little racist, but, you know, I got to put up with that, because I think he's otherwise makes a lot of good points. I love UK politics. Yeah, EU politicians have, look, nobody does. That's my point, though. Nobody who makes decisions has a real clue about the 80%. It's a shame. I mean, it's such a different world. When you move down, most of the people I deal with are employed, have jobs, so on and so forth. So most of the people I'm going to deal with on a daily basis are in the top 10%, even 20%. I don't deal with people who make less than $20,000 a year or $25,000 a year. You know, minimum wage people. I don't really deal with minimum wage people. And I don't mean kids, teenagers. I don't mean the kids of my friends. I mean actual people who live on minimum wage. They can't even live in my neighborhood. They can't live in my state practically. So those people, I had to actually travel to Pennsylvania to really sit down at a bar with a bunch of people who make minimum wage for a living. And they're not represented on television. They're not covered in the news. Nobody wants to hear about how tough it is for a vast majority of Americans. So people, it just ends up being forgotten. Yet, if you activate them politically, and this is why Bernie Sanders is so freaking scary to people, because if you activate those people politically in a democracy, they can vote everybody out of office. That's why you keep them divided. That's why you tell them that they're against each other. That's why you point the Hispanics against the black people, and you put the white people against the black people and the Hispanics, and you tell the white people that the immigrants are stealing all their jobs. That's bullshit. Okay, it is bullshit. Your jobs are not being stolen by freaking nobody in America is stealing anyone's job, okay? All the jobs went overseas. The people who didn't immigrate have stolen your jobs. The people who are still in a factory in China working for 50 cents an hour, they stole your job, not the freaking guy working for $5 an hour, cleaning your grass. He didn't steal your job. You didn't want that job. Okay, all the guys picking fruit in the fields in California did not steal anyone's job, okay? I don't know anybody. I know people in college who've gone and done all kinds of jobs. I don't know anybody who went to go pick fruit in the field. Freaking 12 hours a day in the hot sun. No, that's not, they didn't steal a job, okay? I don't know what world Trump lives in. I really don't, honestly. I don't know what it is where these people think. That, I mean, yeah, sure, on the assembly lines and in the middle America jobs, I'm sure there's plenty of Hispanic people, Mexican people, and so on and so forth that's taken jobs, but they've also become contributing people in the community, and they grow those jobs. The real jobs that get taken is when you send your money out of the country to pay workers in factories where the factory job used to pay $15 an hour here or $20 an hour here. Now it pays 50 cents an hour in China, and the money doesn't go back in the community here. It goes to China, and the person who gets rich is Apple. They stole your job. The manufacturers stole your jobs, but then they have an entire party and a PR mechanism and everything else to convince you that they didn't steal your job. Don't even think about the fact that they obviously stole your job. Frickin', what's his name, Ross Perot told you they were stealing your job in 1980-something, whenever the hell he was running for president. You remember Ross Perot? He was the guy he ran against Clinton, I guess. I don't know. He was running when Clinton first ran, so that must have been 1990. Rob Perot said there was a giant sucking sound from NAFTA, and that was the sound of jobs getting sucked away from this country. He was dead right. 30-something million jobs in a free trade agreement went out of this country. Exactly what Ross Perot told you would happen. And what did it do? It made people incredibly rich. It made corporate America incredibly rich. Hey, that's reality. But what does corporate America do? They buy up all the media channels, they take over the narrative, and they buy up all the politicians, and they tell you now the politicians and the media and everybody who you listen to for an opinion and all the people on the news, they all tell you that the frickin' Mexicans stole your job. Bullshit. They're playing everybody against each other because they sure as hell don't want all the poor people to get together. They don't want me to be sitting, forgive me, I'm rich. They don't want regular people sitting in a room, white people and black people and Mexicans all sitting together saying, hey, that guy stole my job. The freaking guy on TV and his goddamn company stole my job. The Disney Corporation stole my job. Apple stole my job. GM stole my job. They stole all of our jobs. Let's vote them out of office. Let's get rid of them, or let's slap trade tariffs and such on them. That's where the jobs went. That's the truth. So the politicians, and it's the same in the EU, their job is based on dividing that 80% into smaller groups and keep them at each other's throats using ridiculous things that shouldn't matter, like whether or not people can have abortions and so on and so forth, or whether somebody's gay, whatever they can find to divide the group. They subdivide those people so they have no voting power. They take away their voting power by canceling each other out. It's very simple. Divide and conquer. Heard that before, right? So that's what's going on. So, you know, look, and frankly, look, I can't fix it. I can't do anything about it. I can only complain about it. Sometimes I do. I go on rants. But I do my best to make people aware of the thing. I try to change the world, but you know what? I really have. I'm getting old now, so I used to try hard to change the world. Haven't changed it yet. Gets freaking tiring, I gotta tell you. And all these politicians, like I've grown old with some of these politicians too, and used to be so idealistic, and they just get so cynical, and they just weigh you down after a while. And you understand how these guys get to be like, you know, it's old, you know, old politicians, they're just like, whatever. Doesn't matter what you vote for. Doesn't matter what you pass. Because they don't really have power either. The people who pull the strings are the people like, like the Walton family or the Koch family or whoever. Those people are able to influence the markets much more, you know, and influence the voting much more so than they ever could. Because, they know that the Koch brothers can flip the switch and get 50 guys to vote on anything they want, anytime they want. So why would they waste their time, their valuable time? Congress people are kind of busy. You know, good Congress people are pretty busy talking, you know, running around doing stuff. So when they want to get something passed, it doesn't pay them to spend hours and hours going from office to office talking to other Congress people trying to get them to vote on something when they know that they're not going to change their mind. Because they're owned. There's no point. They've tried. They've done it. They've used the arguments. I've been down there. I've lobbied these people. They're not going to change their mind. They're paid not to change their mind. You go down there, you engage a lobbyist, and the first thing they'll tell you is don't even bother with this bunch of people. There's 400 and whatever the hell Congress people, and here's 200 that you can't even talk to. So don't bother with them. Here's 25 guys you might be able to talk to. That's a good lobbyist, though. A good lobbyist does his job. He saves you all the time. And he tells you who to bribe. He tells you which one to give money to so you're actually going to get a vote. Because other guys, no matter how much money you give them, you ain't going to match the guys you pay them. So all these things are factors that you have to take into account when you're investing, when you've got the stocks, when you're looking at the markets, when you're wondering how people are going to decide things over in this country or that country. It all has to be factored into account, and you need to be able to do it objectively. And, look, I'm a liberal, and I don't hide it, because if I hid it, then it would be very dishonest, because that shapes my viewpoints, obviously. It shapes how I look at things. But I'm a liberal. Other people are conservative, but you can't let that be an overriding factor in your decision making. You have to look at everything from both sides. So you think about the strong dollar, and do we really want a strong dollar? And you know, I actually asked Tim Geithner back in when the crisis was happening. I sit and said, "We really want a strong dollar," and he's like, "You know, he couldn't say no, but he was like just laughed at the whole concept. That of course we don't want a strong dollar. It's the last thing we wanted back then. We needed a weak dollar. We would print as many dollars as it took, and now everybody's joining us, and everybody started printing crazy amounts of money, and the supply of money in the world is gigantic, but it's not moving." And that's the other thing, though. There will be inflation. Down the road, there will be inflation. There's inflation now if you pay attention. Okay, when I just went to IMAX, what did we see? Oh, it wasn't good. That stupid Independence Day. Just went to IMAX for Independence Day. $16 a ticket. I remember when I used to complain that IMAX was like $9. It was $8.95, and I used to be like, $8.95, geez, that's like $3 more than a regular movie. And now it's $16. That's inflation. That's really inflation for people who can't afford to go to the movie the whole time. Now, popcorn inflation is way worse than that. So what is that? And why is that? Oh, here's another thing. Why is that happening? Because poor people don't go to the movies anymore. Not as much as they used to, okay? They stay home with Netflix. They Netflix and chill. We wealthy people go to the movies still quite a lot because, frankly, a movie for me is cheap entertainment. I go to less plays, more movies. I used to go to much more plays than movies. Now I go to more movies than plays because plays got ridiculous. But there are people much richer than me who don't think twice about going to plays. And obviously the total attendance on Broadway, anyway, I'll tell you right now, I think if it's 10 million, I think that's probably way too much. Total Broadway ticket sales, that's good. So these are things people don't really think about. Ticket grosses, tickets in Broadway in the U.S., number of people who visited theaters, 45 million, but that's not Broadway. Symphony, 16 million. Revenue for Broadway shows, $1 billion, okay. Total attendance Broadway, 13 million, that's what I said, about 10 million, okay. So 14 million people, let's say, go to Broadway. That's it. 14 million people in the entire country. That means out of the whole country of 300 million people, 0.3%, is that right? Wait, if it was 1%, no, if it was 1%, it'd be 3 million, right? Yeah, if it was 1%, it'd be 3 million. Sorry, 14 million then would be, let's say 4%. So, let's say 5%. Okay, let's say 5%. So, 5% of the people in America get to go to a Broadway show. That's a top 10% thing, isn't it? One time. Now, what really happens is very rich people in New York go to a show a month at least and see almost everything that's on Broadway. And then other people will have once-in-a-lifetime experiences from all over the country. And then in the tri-state area, there's people like me who probably go, you know, once a quarter, you know, is a normal amount, so four times, whatever. I'm a little price sensitive to a Broadway show because it's kind of ridiculous. You know, just from the point of view that I think it's ridiculous, but that's because when I was a kid, I used to go all the time and it wasn't anything like that kind of money. It's hard to enjoy a show. When you go with your wife and two kids to a show and the tickets are $250 each, that's $1,000. Parking is $50. Any kind of dinner in New York City is going to be another $200, $50 a person to have dinner. So you're looking at like $1,500 out of my pocket to go see a show. It's hard to enjoy a show that costs $1,500. I feel the same way about concerts too. I don't care how much I like an artist. If I'm paying $500 a ticket for me and my wife to go to a concert, I have a hard time enjoying the show. I'm just like, I don't know, the album's better. I'm immediately critical of it. When I was a kid and I paid $20, I loved every show. Even if it was bad, I'd be like, hey, cool, I'm at the concert, it's great. It changes your view of things when you do that stuff. So anyway, so that's what's going on with ticket prices. So with the movies, and Broadway too though, the thing is, they've already lost all the people who can't afford tickets. They're never coming. So what they're doing is they're tapping the top 10% who go on an average of once every other year per person. Those people can afford $200 tickets for the once every other year that they go, for the again, on the average. So they jack up the prices higher and higher and higher. And then once you're in there, they say, well, you paid $200 for a ticket, so you don't mind paying $15 for Jack Daniels and Coke. You know, that's how the logic flows. You know, you don't mind paying $5 for a bag of M&Ms because you're an idiot. Movies like that too, same thing. They obviously it's more than the top 10%, but even if you look at movie attendance, you look what they call a blockbuster these days. It's a film that takes in $100 million on opening weekend. $100 million when you're paying $10 a ticket, that means only 10 million people went. That's not that many people. So again, you're talking about experiences that really are in the top 10 to 20%. People in the bottom 50%, they really don't have a movie budget. So things get more expensive. I was in, where the hell was I? Delray Beach, the last weekend. And I've said this about New York City too, it's the same thing that's going on. And this is, and we'll circle back to what this means for the market, because it's very important though. In Delray Beach, there's a ton of empty storefronts. This is one of the greatest places, I'd say, other than Rodeo Drive in America, Delray Beach, Atlantic Avenue it's called, has all the same kind of shops as Rodeo Drive, has way more traffic, foot traffic than Rodeo Drive. Rich people, young people, old people, you have the old people who are well off who shuffle around there all the time. You have all the young rich people who come and they ride around their fancy cars and love to drive up and down the strip and all that. And in the daytime, you have all the women go into all these places, and that's all they do is shop and eat. Every other place is restaurant, shop, whatever. It's all they do working their way up and down the street. And it's great. I love it. It's a great place. Because I like it. That's my crowd. Those are my people. But the problem is, and this has happened in the last 10 years since their last crash, there's a lot of empty stores. And the reason there's a lot of empty stores is because here's what happened. In the last crash, a lot of people who had these long-term leases went bust. Those people dragged down the landlords with them, some of them, the small landlords, the ones who couldn't ride out the recession. Those landlords were then forced to sell their buildings at low prices. Those buildings were bought by very rich people, by comparatively, because people who survived through the crash had a lot of money. Those rich people were able to borrow money at very low cost, okay? So they buy these buildings, and they don't have the pressure to fill the space. So they wait, and they wait, and they wait until a tenant comes in that can afford it. And this is also causing turnover, because the problem is everybody... There's no longer people who have old businesses in the place. So many of these businesses, the old ones, haven't survived. The landlords keep raising the rent. They drive businesses out, the old businesses out, and now the new businesses that come in have to pay ridiculous rents. Those ridiculous rents force them in turn, in order to make their monthly money, those businesses that come in have to then charge ridiculous amounts of money for whatever it is they're selling. If they're like if they're ice cream pops, $5 each. You know, store they were good. You know, gelato pops. They were good, but $5 for a freaking piece of, you know, for a gelato on a stick. The beers were like $8 and things like that. It's like, well, what the hell happened? This place used to be nice. You can go and have a cheap meal and whatever. That's gone. Everything is just jacked up in prices. All the clothes are much more expensive. Everything got more expensive because they can't afford to service poor people. They just can't. They have to cover their rent. And what does that do? That extracts money out of the community, out and out of the store. Even the store owner makes less money, even though he's charging more. So the people in the community have to spend more money. The store owner makes less money, and the landlord gets richer. And who's the landlord? The top 0.01%. And that's what's happening. That's what's happening everywhere. When you go into these towns, why are there so many empty stores? It's because the freaking landlord can borrow money at 0.1%. He doesn't have to worry about making his mortgage payments. He can wait until he gets an expensive store in there. He doesn't have to put a cheap store in there. And that expensive store then has to cover their nut. And when they have to do that, they have to extract the wealth from the bottom 90% that come into their store. And that wealth is extracted, goes through the hands, you pay it at the register, it goes from the guy at the register, goes to the store owner turns it over to the landlord, and the landlord gets the money. Mr. Landlord, right? Like, who's that? Eddie Murphy. Mr. Landlord. So that in a nutshell, is what's going on everywhere. There's a massive wealth extraction process going on. You can see it in the charts. Let's see if we can get a chart up. I'll show you. And you have to be aware of this as you're investing, because this is what's happening everywhere. And the low interest rates are driving the process. Yes, so you mean wealth extraction. Images. Nah, too vague a thing. Wait, what's that one? Yeah, here you go. Let's see if we get a big one on that. So here's everybody, and here's the landlord, and he steps off, and that's the end of it, right? When he has enough money, he leaves, and that's it. And then everybody else is screwed. This is what is happening in the economy, and that's a problem, because what is this? Here. This is actually very accurate, okay? Here's what poor people have. Here's what the rich people have. And as you get higher and higher to the top 1%, it goes completely off the charts. Where 300 people is what I think is what they mean by this. Exposing a system of extraction. But 300 people have as much money as 3 billion people. That's freaking insane. And what it does, though, is it leaves the communities with not enough money. Because the rich people know how not to pay taxes. So the community loses money. It's extracted from the community. The money doesn't go back to the workers' hands. It doesn't get spent locally. It gets spent at the one store and it's gone. And it disappears out of the community, goes to some rich guy who lives somewhere else who owns the store. Used to be every building was owned by a different guy. And that guy probably lives in the community and put money back in the community. That doesn't happen anymore. That's how things get really, really out of whack. And you got to be very careful. You see, we're not even in the early stage of this. We're in a later stage of this. What's this? Global GDP is on the right. Total extraction of raw materials is different. Two kinds of wealth. What's this one say? Oh, okay, yeah. Accumulated. This is what's happening. Rich people are able to accumulate more and more wealth. The people who create actual goods and services are only, making a normal amount of money. They're growing along with the global GDP. But look at how the share used to be. These guys used to get a little bit off the top. Now they get most of it. Financial sector workers, private sector workers. Bankers cash in while others lose out since 1980. Since 1960, really, but since 1980 for sure. This is what's going on. So when you're investing, you've got to realize this is what's going on, and you have to look at the things that you're investing in long term and watch out for these trends. And then the other underlying trend is this population trend, where the demographics are making everybody older and older and older. And, you know, Donald Trump or any top 1% person, they're not looking to fix it. You can't fix it. You really can't. Only the government can fix it by forcing equality. And forcing equality at this point does mean wealth confiscation. Everybody goes, ooh, wealth confiscation. But they already took it all. You have to confiscate the wealth back from the people who took all the wealth. It's gone. If you don't confiscate it, it's going to stay gone. And everything else you do is meaningless. That's where we are now, and that's what this election is going to be about. Although nobody will actually say it that way, and although both people are just shades of the same crap. Anyway, all right, now, so that's what we have to look at, because we're going to start looking for bargains and stocks for the future. We have to think about these things in looking for our stocks and in picking companies that are going to succeed for the next couple of years. Don't count on the consumer to come back. That's the main thing I want to tell you. Don't count on the bottom 80% consumers to come back. It's getting worse and worse for those guys. Even though they're getting more jobs, that's just a blip, because now they're fully employed. And the amount of money companies are making now, there's only a small amount of unemployment now. People are working, they're just getting crap wages for their work. So there's no great comeback expected in the consumers. And you're starting to see it, even McDonald's, lower sales. A lot of retail stocks, lower sales. You know, when they're serving the bottom 80%, there's no money coming back. Walmart, disappointing. Costco was even disappointing. Nike was just disappointing. And why? Because Nike doesn't have $10,000 sneakers. They have to sell, even though they have ridiculously priced sneakers, but they have to sell a lot of sneakers. They have to sell millions and millions and millions of sneakers to make money. But they can't if millions and millions and millions of people, if the bottom 80% people can't afford their sneakers or cut back, nothing Nike does is going to help. And they are not that price. Well, there's an inflexibility. I mean, they're top of the line shoes that rappers buy and stuff like that. They'll buy it for whatever they cost. In fact, the more they charge, Nike's realizing the more they charge, the more people want them. They're status symbols. It's a weird thing. I know that in Florida, my niece has a rapper type friends, and it is funny to actually hear people compliment people on their shoes. Like guys, you know, it's like, hey, good shoes. Like, what? It's like, what is that? I don't even look at shoes. I didn't even know you look at shoes, but these guys are actually caring about what shoes people have. Anyway, so Nike. So you know. You see it bleeding through. You got to watch out for those signs. You got to think about who's sensitive to population, larger populations, and how are they going to get their money? Some people benefit, like dollar stores. Dollar stores are doing great because more and more people are choosing to go to the dollar store to try to save some money. And that, by the way, is just another way of wealth extraction. Because the dollar store is not extracting wealth, but the dollar store is a way that, even though you're getting less money and even though you have less disposable income, you are able at this point in your life, at this stage of the economy, people are able to go to the dollar store now. They first went to Costco. Now Costco, they go from Costco to Walmart to the dollar store. Now the dollar store, once the dollar store becomes too expensive, where do you go? That's the problem. There's a certain place you hit when people are just going to say, oh, screw this. And that's when they're going to get really pissed. Because, you know, if you can easily adjust your lifestyle down and still get by, people are willing to put up with a lot of crap. But if you do put people's backs against a wall at a certain point, that's when you get into chaos. All right, strong dollar and oil going up. So if the dollar goes down, we should see oil high. Right, yes. Yeah, so you give oil a handicap. Okay, it's like when you handicap a horse and you say, well, he's got a lot of weight on him, you know, and so he's going to go slower. It's the same thing. If the dollar's strong, then you have to excuse oil for having trouble getting over 50. Same thing to gasoline. Gasoline. Where is it? There it is. Oh. So gasoline, we're waiting for, well, we waited for 150. We got down to 47.50. We went long there. Then we went long again at 150. And then we went long at 152.50. I wrote those lines out like at the beginning of the week, right? So now 155 is really our goal. Over 155 is bonus money if you get it. But we expected to see 155, and we're getting to 155, slowly but surely. It's grinding up. It's being held down. It's not going fast because of this. But they're going to damn well get there over the weekend because they want to make sure people pay a lot of money at the pump. That's how you extract the wealth. See? See how that's the same premise? That's how they extract the wealth. They have to jack up the price of gasoline here in order to charge you more at the pump so they can take the money out of your pocket. And the money goes out of your pocket, doesn't go into the guy at the gas station's pocket. He doesn't make it. He's got to charge you a very small markup on the gasoline. He has to send that money to much richer people, who in turn send their money to richer people too. And that's how it works. Until you finally get to the top 0.01% guy, Sheboom Pickens, who goes, thank you very much. But how does he do it? He does it by screwing 200 million people out of 10 cents a gallon. That's how he does it. It goes from 146 to 155. That's 10 cents times 10 gallons when you fill up is a dollar. And you get a dollar from 200 million people, that's $200 million. That's what this game's about in one weekend. Gold and silver ratio is starting to show inflation as a book to bill. Inflation is coming. Not only that, though, but currency is, I don't know, currency is a weird thing. You gotta really be concerned that one of these currencies is going to collapse. They're all bullshit anyway. But the way they're printing money and the way these central banks are cheating, I would not be surprised if we find out that some country cheated and printed a ton of money that they didn't reveal, which is kind of what Greece did to get themselves in trouble. The Greek crisis started when a new government came in, a completely different government came in, looked at the books of the old government and blew the whistle and said, hey, these books are cooked. Now, having seen the repercussions of that to Greece, I don't think, because that government was then gone 6 months. Having seen what that did to Greece, I don't think a lot of other countries are going to be doing that, even if they do find out their books were cooked. But Greece did, the Greek government did just what any CEO does when he takes over a company. He finds all the flaws, reveals them in the next quarterly report so that everybody knows it wasn't his fault, and then he goes and shows how great he is by fixing it all. That's what the Greek government thought they were going to do, but instead they collapsed the economy. They're not the only ones. They're just the only ones that got caught. And another crisis like that, and people are going to start losing faith, just like we did kind of in the Greek crisis. People start losing faith in some currencies, and then it's really going to hit the fan. And that's very good for gold and silver. Can you provide your view on BX? We talked about that this morning. BX is Blackstone, and this morning I picked it for a top trade alert. Oh, yeah, here. That's right, we can go to top trade. That was this morning, and we like Blackstone. I said, look, Blackstone they're kind of like a venture capital firm. So they're like a hedge fund, they're like a venture capital firm. They got their fingers in a lot of pots, and they just put their money to work wherever they think they're going to make a profit. That's how Blackstone works. So it's really about, just like if you give your money to a hedge fund manager, it's do you trust the person to manage your money? Do you trust these guys to take your money, your $24.50, are they going to take that money and do something good with it? That's it. It's not complicated. So you can't talk about Blackstone, what did you say exactly? There's no price, sell price, and downside risk. The downside risk is that they made some horrifically bad trade and they get killed. which frankly has already happened. They've already been in bad positions, and unwinding has cost them. Where did I put that thing? Yep. They've already done that. They already screwed up last year. They got killed from 34 here, and they really were at 50 like the year before. They dropped 50% because they were underperforming. Their strategy was wrong. They were on the wrong side of the market, and they screwed up. And now they've adjusted their portfolio, and now hopefully they've got their handle on things, and they're going to do better. And that's where they are, okay? They've generally been a pretty solid performer. They're a good team of guys, and they just made a wrong call. That's why they just fell on the wrong side of the markets. So now they're adjusting. And the trade I made here was, I think, $20 will hold. And you shouldn't look at this chart. Let's look at a longer one. And I think $20 will hold because they're making $2 a share. There's no indication they're not going to make $2 a share. And if you look historically, all the way back, this is going back 3 years, there's no reason to think $20 won't hold. It almost didn't hold here, but you see how it was a spike down? You can't count that. That was nothing. It went down from 24 to 21 in, these are weekly candles, but even if it was for 2 days or 3 days or whatever, it doesn't matter. It didn't last. So the real line that's held up very consistently is this $24 line where we're at now. That's why I like it for trade right now. They've got a declining 200-day moving average. All right, they don't look good. The chart doesn't look good. But I think value-wise, and this is very different than what the chart says, value-wise, I think they should hold 20. And we're close enough to 20 where I want to take a small trade in top trade, a small trade for the long-term portfolio. So we took 10. Now, the long-term portfolio is now a million-dollar portfolio. We've doubled it. So it's not $500,000 anymore. It's a million-dollar portfolio with $2 million of buying power. My risk on this trade is being assigned 1,000 shares of Blackstone at $20. It's $20,000 out of $2 million in buying power. So it's not really, it's a 1%. So our worst case scenario is we have a 1% piece of our portfolio goes to Blackstone. And even if it went to 10, I would be fine about doubling down, I mean, unless there's something drastically wrong with them. But even if they went to 10, I would double down at 10, and we'd have 2,000 shares at 15, and we'd be in for $30,000, and who would care? Okay, that's 1.5% of our portfolio. Don't forget our allocation blocks are 5%. And also, they have nice premiums to sell, which we actually did here. What we did is we didn't do that, but we didn't buy the stock. What we did is we took the bull call spread, 23, because I think 20. See, in my heart, I think 23 is going to hold. But in my head, I'm only going to sell the $20 puts to give myself some more room just in case I'm wrong. So we think 24 is going to hold. So I don't mind taking the $23 puts. I'm sorry, calls, and selling the $30 call. That spread is 230. I subtract the 310 from 230, and that gives us a net 80-cent credit. So if I have an 80-cent credit and I sell the $20 put, my net price is 1920. That's my worst case scenario, is getting this stuff at 1920. That's pretty freaking good. And now logically, if I can sell at 24, I can sell these calls for 365, right? So let's say it does drop down to 20 and I get assigned. I know that I'll be able to sell the $20 calls for maybe $3 for 2020. And that'll drop my basis from 1920 to 1620. That's the logic of this trade. It's not the one trade. It's saying, well, okay, what's my worst case? My worst case is I get assigned. I only get assigned if it's below 20. If it's below 20, that means that this went out of the money, so I maybe recover nothing from it. But if it goes below 20, I have the stock, and if I want to keep it then, I just go and sell $20 calls for $3. That lowers my basis further, and I can sell more puts at that. Don't forget, if I'm assigned, it means my puts disappeared, so I can then sell more puts for $3 also. Now I've lowered my basis from 19 to 16 to 13. And if you don't want to own 2,000 shares of Blackstone for $13. Why would you buy one share for $24? You've got to follow through with the logic on these trades, okay? If you're making the trade, you're making a commitment. And if you're making a commitment, you better be damn sure you want to go through with it. When you start selling puts and you start committing to owning a stock, you have to think through the logic of owning that stock. And Blackstone's not a fly-by-night operation. They're almost probably not going to go bankrupt. They have various holdings. Some do well, some do badly. They're spreading their money around all over the place on all kinds of stuff. And they're generally pretty smart guys. They can be wrong once in a while, but that doesn't mean they're always going to lose money. Look, Warren Buffett lost money. He's had bad years. It's how you perform over time that matters. And with Berkshire, it's the same thing. You want to buy him in the bad years. You don't want to buy him in the good years. Everybody's buying him in the good years. You've got to buy him in the bad years. You've got to say, you know what? He's a good guy who had a bad year, so I'll buy him while he's cheap. That's what these guys are. They're good guys. They had a bad year. There's no such thing as what's your risk, though. Your risk is losing the money. Your risk is being assigned 1,000 shares for a net of $19,200. That's your risk. After that, though, I would then sell more puts and calls. But with any single stock, your risk is they could go bankrupt, and then you have $19,200. But if it goes well, this trade will make $15,000, I think we decided. It'll make $7,800 if it goes well. So that's 32% of the current price. It's like 40% of 1920. So of your net risk, you make 40% of 1920 if they can get back to 30, right? Yeah, 30. And if you look at the bigger picture, 30 is only halfway back to where they were. All right, so in a year and a half, 18 months, we think they're going to get back to this spot. That's what that trade is. But even if they stay right here, still makes money. That's the kind of trade I like to make. Wells Fargo, do you want exposure to oil and margin pressure? What? For Wells Fargo? Do you see a good buy point here? I don't know what Wells Fargo's exposure to oil is. Okay, that's a weird question for Wells Fargo. Unless I'm misunderstanding something here. Do I see a good buy point for Wells Fargo? It's a bank. I wouldn't touch the banks right now. The rates are going up. It's going to be a weird environment. The British banks are Blackstone and RBS are in huge amounts of trouble. Other banks may be in trouble. Back to Cascade. You don't know who got affected by the Brexit until you see the books on the financials. So, no, I wouldn't touch any of these guys. Okay, financials are not a place I really want to play with right now. YMTF at or above your lines. Yeah, well, not really doing the futures today. This is very strong. Considering how strong the dollar is, this is all very strong. We're recovering nicely. But also very important, as I pointed out, the long-term portfolio is probably up around 100% again. Yeah. So during the day today, we started off, I don't forget where we started, but anyway, so the bottom line is we've got, well, a million, obviously, if we're up 100%. So we're at $1 million here, and the short-term portfolio, you would assume, is getting killed. Whoops. Let's see how the short-term, because the short-term portfolio is bearish. 410%, so that is 510. So we're at 1,510. No! Oh, it's so weird. All right. So since this morning when I told people this is why I don't worry about it, because we're balanced. That is wacky. You almost feel like you can't lose money sometimes. No? Ah. Long-term portfolio this morning, 1505. And now we have 1502, we have 1,000,002 plus S, and now we're at 1512. We gained $7,000. The short-term portfolio fell, 5.10. The short-term portfolio fell from 5.13 to 5.10. So very little, we lost $4,000 about in the short-term portfolio, but we gained in the long-term portfolio. Wait, 5.13, sorry. 5.13. 5.10, yeah. We didn't really get hurt that badly in the short-term portfolio. That's what happened. But the long-term portfolio picked up a lot of money. It went up $10,000. So we gained $10,000 here, and we only lost $4,000 here. We netted like $6,000 more for the day, even though it was an up day. Why? Because we're super-duper balanced, but mostly in the long-term portfolio because the VIX keeps going down, and the VIX goes down, and we sold a lot of premium. So the poor people who sold as premium are losing out as the VIX goes up. That's why the system works so well. But you have to follow the system to let it work. You can't randomly reinterpret it as you wish. You don't have to have the same stock. You have to have the same concept of selling a lot of premium all the time. Because no matter what happens in an up market, in a down market, in a flat market, the premium expires on the person you sold it to. Even when it goes his way, the premium still expires. Okay, so in this BX trade, way to go. In this Blackstone trade, I sold the $20 put for 3.10. Blackstone's not a 20, it's a 24. 24.50. He paid me 3.10. He's really paying me 3.10 in direct premium plus another 4.50 in position premium. This guy is paying me $7.60 of premium. That's how far out of the money he is. This thing has to fall $7.60, about 30%, for him to just get his freaking money back. Those are the kind of trades we make every day. That guy's an idiot. That's why I like to trade. Somebody asked me, GC asked me this morning, I think it was, right? Yeah, GC, sorry, one of the people. GC asked me this morning, what do I think of Blackstone? I think Blackstone's okay, and I wrote, in fact, while I'm writing, here's my thought process. I do like them when they're cheap, and I said, well, they are kind of cheap. Okay, so you never know what skeletons investment funds have in their closets. It's questioning trust in the management team of your money, just like any fund, just like I was saying to you guys just now. Hard to say how the Brexit affects them, uncertain. Perhaps they're on the wrong side of things. The lack of IPOs, though, is what's been killing them. They're heavy in the IPO market, and there's been no IPOs, and that's why it's been so dead for these guys. It might start coming back in the second half of the year if we survive the summer. That's a big caveat to everything right now, if we survive the summer. All right? But then when I looked at the chart, and I looked at the options, I looked at the number. I said, oh, they're going to make this $1.82 a share. They look like they're on track for that. So $40 was too high, but at $24, I don't mind. Now I'm in a PE of like of 20. I can deal with that. Like 13, 14. So my PE is like 13 here. If they get back to $3 a share, the PE is 8. And they have a history of earning that kind of money. So if things get better, they'll get better fast, and that's what I'm counting on. That's why my target is 30. I think they'll get to $3. They'll easily carry a 10 PE, and we'll be at 30. But anyway, given all that, that doesn't make it a trade. That just makes me say, oh, it's attractive. But then when I looked at the options for him, after looking at that and thinking, you know what, it's not so bad at this price. I think we can justify the price. Now I look at the options. Then I see there's some moron who wants to pay $3.10 because he thinks Blackstone will be below 20. He's betting me $3.10 Blackstone will be below 20. He's a moron. That's a ridiculous spread to pay, and he deserves to lose his money. I'm happy to take it from him. All right? That's when it becomes a trade. Once I saw that, I said, ooh, that's good. Then I say, well, now I can be the moron and buy the $23 calls for $365. I'm not as much of a moron as he is because the $23 calls are in the money. So they're $150 in the money. I'm paying $2 a premium, but I sold this sucker $3 a premium. But even that doesn't make me happy. I don't like to pay any premium, so I turn around and sell the $30 calls because I don't need more than $30. I'm going to be thrilled if I get to $30. So the $30 calls for $1.35. Now I've wiped out all of the premium I've sold. I've got a credit on the spread. That's how you make a position. That's what makes me like Blackstone, though. The fact that there was also very expensive options on them made me like them. On a different day with different priced options, I wouldn't like the trade. It all factors in. It can't just, you know, you see a car, it shouldn't be. I know most people don't do this. You see a car, it shouldn't just be that you like the car. There are lots of cars you like. It's got to be a car you like that's also a very good price for the money, that's on sale, that has a great deal, so on and so forth. Same thing goes for a house, right? There are lots of houses in the world. Keep looking if you don't find one that's a good deal. And the same goes for stocks. There are 9,000 stocks traded out there. You don't need to buy this one. If it's not a good deal at the same time as it's a good stock, don't get it. There are so many good deals. And as we said, we said we'd start looking for them. I already found two today that we liked. I see a market opportunity for the nickel store. Yeah, it's next stop nickel store, right? Yeah, what it used to be Woolworth, right? The five and dime. I loved that when I was a kid. See, and my kids love the dollar store. Well, not anymore, but they used to anyway. My kids were little. I would give them $5 each and say, hey, go have fun. And they'd be like, yay! They can go in there and get five things. Until they learn the horror of taxes. I had to give them $5 in, what is it, 35 cents. Because it's 7 cents tax. They learned about the harder taxes from the dollar store. But they love that, yeah. I mean, when I was a kid, my boss used to give me like 50 cents and let me go crazy in Woolworths. And I would have just thought, who cares? You come home with a bag full of crap. It's fun. But now they have food. They never had, I don't remember them having food. Maybe they just didn't care when I was a kid. I don't remember them having food in Woolworths. The dollar store is full of food now. Like all kind of old snacky food and stuff. But it's like, I guess people live off that stuff these days. Did the UK join, April, did the UK join Europe? What? Oh, the S&P is up, I see. No, it wasn't worth the sell-off. And now, see, here's the thing. Because there was a sell-off, everybody now thinks the Fed is on hold forever. Literally, the bet's on now, 2018 is the earliest the Fed's going to raise rates, even though they told you they're going to raise rates. And now think about how wrong they are, because we for the most part, reversed the drop. Half the drop is gone. We dropped 120 points, now we're back at 2060, right? We were at 2120, right? And now we're at 2060 on the S&P. We fell to 2000. So we've reversed 50% of the drop, yet the market is still playing as if the Fed is going to be on hold forever because of the drop that now has been reversed. They're playing that the dollar will be that the dollar will be weaker. They're playing that the yen will have to intervene, even though it reversed. Everything reversed. How can you still think? So now they're saying we're going to get much more stimulus. We're going to get much cheaper this. We're going to have lower rates because of the drop. That didn't happen. That lasted for 2 days. Oh, I don't know. There was that. Must have been yesterday. I don't know. I don't know if it came out. I sent it. It was a very funny shirt, but somebody made a T-shirt that said, "I survived the 2-day crash of 2016" or something like that. It was well worded. But anyway, you get the point. Now it's like it's so stupid because the flash literally the markets crashed for 48 hours. Now they're all back. Nah, I don't think it came out because it was. Sometimes when I send something, it was a tweet, it doesn't work. Anyway, point being, though, obviously, that this wasn't, there's not even a correction. And when you look at this thing on a weekly chart, I think you probably, STX. Ah, here, see the weekly chart? It didn't happen. This week, we're finishing higher than last week. This week, we're at the same place we were 2 weeks ago. This week, we're at the same place we were in May. So why would the Fed be changing their policy if we're in the same place where they set their policy? Why would there be emergency bailouts and all kinds of stimulus all of a sudden happening when we're at the same frickin' place? Okay, investors are idiots. I think I made that point earlier, right? This is just stupid. Now, if we fail this 50-day moving average, very important spot here, 2075, right? 2076, actually. If we fail here and we go back to test 2025, and then we fail that, then we're into a much bigger correction for other reasons. But this was a very strong hold, actually. It's very impressive, and we've got the dollar working against us. So frankly, we practically are fully recovered. All right, what's 2075 plus 3% of the dollar moved up, right? So we take 2075 times 1.03, 2137, new all-time high if you factor in the dollar. Wow, that's more than I thought. Okay, so in other words, if you factor in the fact that the dollar went 3% against us, went up 3% and made everything 3% lower, we actually made a new high after the Brexit. So investors might not look at things that way, but the Fed sure does. They know how to take the dollar into account. They're not as stupid as the investors are. So we're not down at all. You factor in a constant dollar, and the market is now higher than it was before the Brexit. Oh, and you want to see something weird? This is the weirdest thing. FTSE. The FTSE's higher. Is that not crazy? The FTSE is higher than it was in the beginning of June post-Brexit. That's the freaking London Financial Times Index. 100 top stocks in England. Higher than before the Brexit. 788, so say 800 to 400, we're looking at, 600 points, 10%. It went 10% down and 10% back up in 4 days. How's that for a ridiculous, insane, overreaction, much ado about nothing kind of move? So if England's stock market is fully recovered, why aren't we fully recovered? The only reason we're not fully recovered is because the dollar strength is hiding how strong our recovery is. But that then means the Fed is still on the table, which means the biggest wrong thing right now going on is TLT. These guys are totally wrong. TLT, and we're short TLT in one of the portfolios. These guys are totally wrong. And today it's up 2.74%. So this is a great short. TLT at 140, great short. All right, where do we have that in the 5% portfolio? This is the options opportunity portfolio, just originally was called that. TLT, so even though, okay, here. We have the 135 puts. We're wrong. We got killed. It ain't going to come back by July. We only have 2 weeks. But I think we're going to roll these up. Not in July. We'll have to roll them up in August. We're going to be right eventually. We already lost the first ones we did in June. Now we're going to lose these. But I don't care. I'm going to keep betting it because eventually it's going to pay off. They're totally wrong now, though. So I really like shorting TLT here at 139.63. And even though we're wrong, even though we lost $1,700, our mix is good because we're still up 60.5% in that portfolio. And the butterfly portfolio, I bet, is on fire right now. 167%. So the butterfly portfolio is doing nicely. This morning it was lower, I'm pretty sure. And again, it's the same concept, though, because we're selling the premium, we're beating the house, and that's improving. As the VIX goes down, we automatically make money because the suckers we sold premium to are getting killed. Butterfly. 268. Actually, no, it's flat. Let me see. Is that right? 268, 267, yeah. Okay, so the butterfly is flat for the day. But still made a nice recovery for the week, so it's been up there. So all of that portfolio is basically at their all-time highs with the market at its all-time high. But the best part about it is we didn't lose any money on the way down. We did very well. A 5% market correction barely hurt us. That means we have incredibly good balance, and all that premium we're selling is just grinding away, and we're going to make more and more money without even touching our portfolio. And we don't even care if the markets go up or down. We're going to make money. So that then, since we have so much cash on the sideline, that then lets me be brave and start adding positions. Since we're so solid and so steady, we can start adding a position here and a position there, keeping the balance, you know, keeping balance on one side and the other, but we can start adding more and more positions and making more bets and attaching it because we have this really powerful locomotive that's driving our portfolio that we can add more cars to and make more money. All right, time to wrap it up. Last couple of questions. You don't think that Fed's... Oh, now, the market may be driven up by... Yeah, that's true. The market may be only driven up by window dressing at the end of the quarter. We don't trust it. But I'm telling you, this is a hugely strong recovery all the way back. Basically, we've completely reversed. At this point, we have completely reversed the drop, if not for the dollar. When you see the frickin' FTSE, which is England's index, going back over where it was before it started, then you know that there's no reason we shouldn't be back at our highs. But on the other hand, some of the reasoning behind it is wrong. Like, it's not because the Fed is off the table. If anything, the Fed's going to be like, oh my God, you can't stop this market. This is the best time ever to raise rates. If I were the Fed, I would say this market is completely bulletproof. Doesn't matter what you do, they come up with another reason to be bullish. So let's raise rates, and I bet they come up with a reason to be bullish about that. But if you're not going to do it now, when we're at the all-time highs, when the hell are you going to do it? If the market gets back to normal, Super VIX should be as good as VIX, good as VIX drops. I have no opinion on this VIX. The VIX is a stupid, stupid measurement. It goes up and down like crazy for no particular reason. And also, why would I bet the VIX to go lower at 17? I would have bet the VIX to go lower at 25 like Jean-Luc did, because that's when it goes lower. You can see it. Great place to short, great place to short, great place to short. Still get burned for $5, but a great place to short in general, even here. It's a great place to short, but you get burned for $20 or 20, yeah. So if you're shorting the 25 line, this burned you for $20 before it came back down, but it still came back down. So if you got the balls, then yeah, sure, play the VIX, but if you make a mistake, this is what happens to you. I don't like to play things like that. That doesn't happen to me with IBM. IBM doesn't go from 200 to 450 and back. Certainly not in a day. I mean, this is one day. Look, this is 2 days. You know what that move is? 15 to 25 and then to 30? That's 100% in 3 days. And you're 1790 and you want to talk about shorting? No, I'm not even going to pretend to say that's okay. I'm not even going to placate you with that trade. Okay, that's completely irresponsible. You're in the lower end of the normal range for it. You have no particular advantage to making the trade. You are gambling. and you're gambling on something that you'll get a minor payoff if you're right, and you can get completely screwed if you're wrong. Makes no sense. How would I trade TLT today? Well, it's a real thing. We have to move ours. Ours are worthless, so we're not. How many times am I going to do that? Okay, ours are. We have the July 135 push or something like that. Show more stripes. Okay. So we have like the 135 puts, and we thought we were clever, but they're down to 35 cents. So we want to move to something in, let's give it another month. I hate to keep giving it a month because it never seems to work out, but we'll give it another month. And, look, it's only a buck. It's only $1.10 to go to the 135 puts. I still like the target because this is stupid. This move up was dumb. So it doesn't change my overall target. It just changes the time frame in which I think we're going to hit it. So it's going to cost me another buck to move to there. Now, is it worth it? Now, then another logic kicks in. If I'm in that position, and I think we're going to be below 135, obviously I do, so then I say, well, okay, it cost me 35 cents to move to the next strike. Well, sure, I'll pay 35 cents for another dollar. Then I say, okay, well, from there, it cost me 40 cents to go to 137. Well, yeah, I'll pay 40 cents to make a dollar. Now it costs me 50 cents or 45 cents to go to 138. Yes, I will go to 138 because I think it's worth another 45 cents to make a dollar. Now from here, it's 50 cents to the 139, and that's where I'm going to put my foot down. So I'm going to pay $1.20 more to have the 138 puts instead of the 135 puts. Because I'm buying $3 a position for $1.20 and my target is really 130. So I'm going to get all that money back and it's a good bet. And that's how I decide what position I want to be in, okay? I'm going to pay the least amount of premium I can in the best position I can. So to roll to this position is going to cost us $2.30, and for $2.30 we're going to buy $3 in position and 30 days of time. And hopefully we'll get it right this time. So we did hedge. We bought back our short caller. We bought back the short puts. I don't even want to sell puts right now because I just think this is such a bloated, stupid position. 139.36 on TLT. So that's my mark. I say short. I certainly would have shorted at 140 if I saw it. All right, and that's it. We're up to the 2-hour mark. We must kill our seminars in 2 hours or it's way too long. Anything else going on? Oh, well, okay, let's take a look at oil and gas. I cannot believe it. On my machine, that's where it is. On my main machine, that's where my thinkorswim is. Damn it. I feel like such an idiot. Okay. We're too strong. The dollar's too strong. These things are doing well despite the strong dollar. I can't in good conscience short here, as tempting as it may be to do so. What I can do, and what we will do tomorrow, though, is we're going to roll our short hedges, our hedge positions, we're going to roll them to be more aggressive. So we're going to spend a little bit of money and lock in these gains. Because by making our hedges more aggressive, we're locking in these higher levels, right? So where we can, I don't know where we can, I don't know if it's going to be a good deal. Again, I won't pay more than 50 cents for a dollar position. But where we can and where it's a reasonable thing to spend the money on, we're going to buy more time, buy better position, and then once we have our insurance in place, we can then start buying more stuff and going longer on things to balance it back out. And I see oil just tested 50 and it's coming down a bit. Now, see, oil with strong dollars is a tough road. RB, I like the 152.50 line long. Did we hit 155? What the hell is that? What's that spike? Look at that spike. Oh, my God, that's our target. 1546. Damn it. Well, I'm very proud of anybody who took the money and ran on that. Holy crap. When was that? 2:20. Missed it, right? That's right into the NYMEX close. It spiked up like crazy. So good. Let it settle back down. Hopefully 152.50 will hold, and that's a good place to go back long again into the weekend. And again, we're going for 155. 155, that's like a $1,000 move if you get 2.5 cents on the gasoline contracts. On the other hand, though, if it fails 152, the next line of support is down at 150. So do not be a hero. If it is 152.50 does not hold, get the hell out and wait and see what happens, because maybe it'll come back down to here. Maybe it'll come all the way down to here. Who knows? You know, this stuff can whip around really hard and really fast. And watch oil, of course. If oil's over 50, then gasoline's going up. If oil's under 50, then we'll see how it calms down and matches. But honestly, there's not a lot I want to play right now. I've got, you know, look, we perfectly balanced out our portfolios. I'm very happy with that. I'm very happy to watch and wait and see what happens. And then when we see something obvious, like we did today with Blackstone and we did with Labu, that was the other one. Oh, damn it, one more thing. Did we not talk about that? I think we didn't really talk about it. My trade of the year and a half, UNG, that's already where we expect it to be. It's already at $9, right? I assume it's at $9 or close. UNG. Yeah. So UNG is basically at our goal. Now that it's over this 200-day moving average, we're going to be in probably great shape. Our goal was $9 for the end of the year. We're already at it, so that trade is basically done. The new trade for the second half of the year then is Labu. Labu is the ultra 3x long on IBB. IBB is a biotech ETF. And my point was that VRX destroyed the IBB. Here's IBB, here's VRX, here's VRX dying, here's IBB dying with it. Little bit delay action, but it's dying with it. Flat, dead. Everybody got disgusted by biotech and left. But meanwhile, there's still plenty of phenomenal things going on in biotech. They're freaking curing cancer. They're curing all sorts of diseases. They're finding they're now editing your genes. So that now if you don't like your eye color, you can go get your eye color changed, things like that. It's a whole new world, okay? So I really want to be in this long term. This is obviously one of those evil ultra ETFs that decays over time, but frankly the options only go out until December. And we're primed. You can't, you know, when you're in an ultra ETF, you really got to look at the main ETF. You can't go by the lines that you see on the ultra because those make no sense. But the main ETF, you can see you got some good support here. Last time we were down at 24, we got buying up to. I'm sorry. Last time we were 240, we got buying up to here, and all the way back up to close to 300. So my goal is really to get back to around 300 here. This trade is a new Labu trade. I'm talking about selling December 20 puts, and let's remember that they're at 24 now, I think. 28, sorry, they're at 28. And we're selling the 20 puts. We've never been below 20. I'm selling December 20 puts for $435. Oh, my God, I mean, that's a huge amount. Again, sucker, right? $435, that's 20% when you get to 20, and 20 is $8 below where we are now. That's insane. This person is an idiot. Then we buy the 25 calls. That person's an idiot too. We're the idiot here, paying $750 for the 25 calls when it's 28. But then we're going to find a bigger idiot who's going to buy the $40 calls from us for $275. That drops our price on the 25 calls to $750. Still sucks. We're still paying $30. I'm sorry, it's net. The net. Our net is like a little less. Our net is $475. So we're paying $29.75. And the stock is at $28.25. So we're paying $1.50 in premium. But then we're offsetting that by selling the puts. So we end up with a good net on the overall trade. Net 40, in fact, overall. All right? And at net 40, since we own the 25 puts, now we're paying $25.40 for stock at 28. Now I feel good about it, right? And understand though that if we go below 25, we're only into net 40, and we don't get assigned until 20. So really, our worst case scenario is getting assigned at 2040. And what do we say about the $20 line? It has never been broken. Our worst case scenario is owning this for 2040. And then we get to sell these ridiculously expensive calls. And again, this is the thing, you gotta think through your position, okay? If we get it assigned at 2040, we'll sell the $20 call for $5. Then our net will be 15. I don't mind that. I don't mind the worst case. If I don't mind the worst case, I like the trade. That's how I look at this. And don't forget, ETFs don't go bankrupt, okay? As you can see, even when one of its biggest holdings goes bankrupt, essentially, it went from 250 to 20. It took this, so that's 99%. So this thing drops 90%+, one of the biggest holdings. The ETF itself, though, went from 360 to 240, dropped 30%. And it wasn't just VRX that went down, though. VRX took huge amounts of companies with it, because anything in even a vaguely similar part of the business, all the biotech lost their luster, everybody got out of the sector, money flew out. That's the best time to get into an ETF. Everybody else pulled their money out. Now the ETF is ridiculously cheap. Now's the time to get in and buy it. So it's a great way to get into biotech and spread your risk. We don't have any biotech stocks. I have not officially made this trade for our portfolios yet. I just like it. So I want to write it up here. And I have to consider tomorrow, the next day, whether we're going to add to it. I might even wait till next week, because there's so much money in this trade, it doesn't matter if we wait. I probably want to put it in the long-term portfolio, but I have to just still consider the balance. I gotta consider how well balanced we are and what we want to do. All right, so that's my trade of the year, of the second half of the year, though. Officially, this trade, more than any other trade I can think of, including Apple, very impressive when something beats Apple. I like this trade so much, I will call this my trade of the second half of 2016. I think there's an incredibly good chance of making a 500% return on the cash, which is you put in 40 net, you're going to get back $15. That's a lot. I don't know how that works out to you, but it's like 7,500% or something like that. It's a lot. Very nice return on your money. All right. That's a great way to end the seminar. Everybody go out and make 7,500% on your money by December, and we'll all be very happy. All right. Have a good day, everybody. Take care.